Good afternoon. After such an exhaustive and wonderful presentation by Dr. Neeraj, sir, we kind of understand as to how to begin the process of setting our own unit and then how to go about segregating our normal patients with COVID patients. So coming to the other side of the story, that is, how do we take care of babies and how does the baby care changed with this pandemic that just engulfed our day-to-day practices? So I'll be going over the preparedness, the guidelines that are available, and then the well-baby care, and of course the care of a sick neonate, how it is different from otherwise normal care of non-COVID patients. So when we, the first Indian case was first reported on 30th of January 2020, and ever since the numbers have been rapidly increasing. As of May 1st, there were 32,000 odd cases. And by May 18th, we gone past the landmark of 1 lakh cases. The current doubling time is 11 days odd. So one thing is clear that all the delivery units and the team should be geared up to make the whole process as safe and as segregated as possible from their routine non-COVID day-to-day practice. So life like we knew it completely changed. Our days are revolving around hand hygiene, respiratory hygiene, trying to maintain social distance as much as possible, and of course, taking care of high-risk group being medical faculty. And this spilled over even to our perinatal health and COVID-related perinatal health that we see day in and day out. Now, this brings us to a set of basic questions when it comes to fetus and neonate. The first being, will it affect the baby formation? In other words, does it have any teratogenicity? So as of today, it's only about 3 to 4 months since the first documented case of COVID. So the data that is available is very limited. So teratogenicity so far has not been documented. When we compare it with other similar viruses, like the influenza virus or the MERS-CoV or something, or similar viruses, probably it is not so teratogenic. And the product of conception that is available from the studies that are done based on histopathology of abortions so far didn't show any signs of virus or virus-related abnormal formation of the product. So reproductive societies, however, offer a caution saying that delay all elective fertility procedures, but if pregnancies are conceived, I think they should be offered normal care like ever. The second question that brings us to, when as neonatologists, we are more interested or worried about is, will it cause more early deliveries or preterm deliveries? Now, when we look at the worldwide data, yes, there is a slightly increased trend towards preterm labor. But when we segregate whether it is done for the sake of maternal health or whether it happened because of premature labor per se, given the symptomatology of the mother, in those mothers who are asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, there is absolutely no increase in prematurity in all the case series that we have seen. However, in overtly symptomatic mothers, for their own health, of course, the delivery is terminated prematurely. So whether you will have a preterm baby in the pregnancy or not is dictated by the symptomatology of the mother. The third and the most important doubt that we have when we deal with this kind of babies is, whether it gets passed on to the baby, whether there is an in utero transfer from mother to baby. Now we have about 150 odd pregnancies with COVID positive with documented evidence as of April 20th, that's the last cumulative data. None of the studies have shown that there is a possible in utero transfer from the mother to the fetus. There's one that came out in the last week which showed that there's a second trimester abortion where the placenta is actually infested with the viral infection. Otherwise, in utero transfer from mother to fetus seems to be very limited or possibly absent. The few babies where they have been tested very early in life, like less than 36 hours of life, probably there is a chance of postnatal contact transmission rather than from mother to the baby. So if the question is asked whether it goes from mother to baby, probably there is no evidence at this point to support any such thing. And if at all there is any risk, it's very, very minimal as compared to many other infections. Now, a few antenatal important considerations as neonatologists and as perinatologists, like both obstetricians and neonatologists, what we are concerned about. Antenatal corticosteroids can be given and probably should definitely be given in extreme preterms and then very preterms. Proceed with caution because steroids in the setting of an infection is always a tricky scenario. antenatal Maxell that is given for neuroprotection in all preterm deliveries less than 32 weeks, please proceed as usual. There's absolutely no problem with any of these kind of medications. And an important area here is antenatal counseling. I think it is very important that all ladies who are due for delivery in this pandemic time should be offered one detailed antenatal counseling as to how the hospital addresses the scenario differently, when all she should actually contact the delivery unit beforehand, such as if she has fever, if she has cold cough, if she has any of those symptoms. I think she should intimate the center beforehand so that adequate precautions, the right mode of entry into the hospital and the right labor room for them should be guided. And of course, the important other aspects, such as the number of people who can accompany her, whether they will be with her in the labor suit or not, all these smaller, finer aspects of discussion should probably be happening much before, rather than having the discussion when she's already in labor. Now, how do we prepare for delivery? Dr. Neeraj extensively dealt with this area, how we should have a separate OT, separate labor room. Right from the entrance, they should be received by a different set of people, should have personal protective gear, equipment, and all should be on. Here, there's only one point I would like to highlight and probably stress upon is drills. Drill is nothing but a mock run of how you would do if you have a normal pregnancy and a lady who is coming with suspect infection differently. The whole team, starting from the front security to your front desk, to your nurses, to your residents, everybody should be aware of how these two are different. And conducting a drill will expose the finer detail. Even the smallest details, such as where are the PPE kits located? Where do I get them during off hours? Where is the key for the locker where we find them? All the smaller details are possible only if we do multiple drills at various time frames. Once we run the drill and then debrief at the end of the drill saying that, okay, these are done very well. These are the areas where we need to improve. And this is how we would want to communicate with the families. Coming to neonatal resuscitation. Okay, so the first question is, where do we resuscitate these babies? Okay, so as long as if we are dealing with a lady who is under question, if she has fever or cold cough or any reason, for any reason we suspect, if she is a person under investigation called PUI, then as much as possible, the baby should be resuscitated as far from the mother as possible. In the sense, if you have a possibility of an interconnected separate area of resuscitation, that would be ideal. If it's in the same room, we should try and maintain at least 2 meter distance and probably separating a curtain in between. Mother, if she has any doubt about this COVID, probably she should also highlight upon the fact of hand hygiene, wearing mask even throughout delivery. A triple layered mask is the Indian guideline, N95 is the CDC guideline, but any form of mask should be applied onto the mother so that the aerosols don't spread when she is in the process of labor. Personnel, as far as possible, we should limit the number of people we use. Say, for example, if you have a low-risk delivery, one person taking care of neonatal resuscitation is more than enough. If it's a high-risk delivery, a preterm delivery, probably two people should be ready for geared up for the resuscitation. A model labor delivery area should look like this, where we should probably use the existing electronic media, such as virtual interaction with the partner, the doctor, the mother, if you notice, is wearing a mask for source containment. The doctor conducting delivery is on full kit. The doctor ready for resuscitation on full kit. And there is an additional personnel waiting outside. If at all there is more need for resuscitation hands, then probably they should be pitching in. The flowchart of resuscitation is more or less the same. It is the same as what you would practice normally in a normal neonatal resuscitation. However, there are a few differences here and there. For the routine care, Indian guidelines, both FOCSI and our IAP NNF guidelines say that since we don't know much about this virus at this point, we would say there is no routine delayed cord clamping. Clamp the cord immediately and then separate the baby from the mother so that the source containment or infection from the mother to baby is minimized. No skin-to-skin contact. Otherwise, normally we do skin-to-skin contact with delayed cord clamping is probably not offered in this case to prevent, again, spread of infection. The feeding decision is a combined decision made with the family. I will be talking about in a minute. When we have to use a positive pressure ventilation, that is in the form of resuscitation, the baby doesn't cry at birth, where we use either a TPS resuscitator or a bag and mask ventilation, all aerosol generation stuff, such as use of suction apparatus is probably less preferred. We would like to use a mucus bulb sucker. Use a Bagging mask is probably better than using a T-piece. And if you have to intubate, probably a barrier hood box kind of thing, which keeps the baby and the person who's intubating away from each other with an access point. I'll be just showing you how we do that. If you look at this, this is a model diagram, but if we connect a drill, this is one of the rainbow units where we connected a drill. So this is the hood we're talking about, separates the baby from the person who's doing resuscitation in the full gear, and then accessing it through the minimal access that is given in that hood box where we try to access the baby and do the resuscitation. Regarding if the baby is well, say for example, baby cries at birth, baby is fine, the mother is fine, mother is mildly symptomatic, or mother is fine. In an ideal world where there is no community spread, probably this baby deserves to be isolated from the mother, because mother is probably, we need to rule out the infection in the mother, and the baby needs to stay away from the baby and be nursed by a person who has never been in contact with the mother or another COVID patient. Mother can express milk because breast milk is safe, breast milk is good, and there is no evidence that breast milk contains the virus. So she can follow hand hygiene, wear a mask, wear a sterile glove if the resources allow, express the milk, and offer it to the baby. Mother should be tested as per guidelines of the locality, and if she's cleared of infection, they both can be roomed in together. But in conditions where there are resource poor, like probably many of our centers are like that, then, or those countries where there is a lot of community spread already in place, then we room the both mother and baby, and they both should be separate from the rest of the patients that we have in the hospital. Direct breastfeed should be initiated where the mother continues to wear mask. Plan an early discharge so that both the baby and mother can reach home, and teleconsultation wherever it is possible. So WHO, this is one of the WHO's infographics, says that the mother should practice proper respiratory hygiene. She should wash her hands, clean surfaces, and continue to breastfeed as much as possible. She should be supported in both for expressing of milk, if relactation, when she's comes back, when she had been unwell, if she's been cared for, and then subsequently she is declared negative, she comes back, relactation should be offered in these babies. See, if you have the same baby was born to your mother under investigation, the baby is sick, baby needs ICU, the ICU should be specially designed for these purposes, or the ICU should have at least negative suction pressures of 12 air changes per hour, double door entry, as much as possible incubator care individually for all the babies, and designated staff separated from the mainstream staff caring for the normal ICU care. So this ICU is a segregated COVID and neonatal ICU with negative suction and completely different set of staff taking care of the babies. How do we test? When do we test? Say, for example, if the mother tests positive subsequently at the time of delivery or a little later, if the baby is asymptomatic, test the baby, and if the baby is negative, repeat the test after 48 hours. If the baby is symptomatic, assume there is COVID infection, test immediately, and then take things forward. Irrespective of the result, there is no medication at this point that is offered for children or especially neonates. The sample is tracheal aspirates. For those babies who are otherwise well and not ventilated, then nasopharyngeal swabs are enough. Regarding routine ICU changes, so in this COVID scenario, as the routine NICU which is running as usual, we should try and make enough changes so that the COVID from the community doesn't enter the ICU. So for this, we limit the number of people entering the ICU, preferably none other than the mother should be allowed into the ICU. Milk expression facilitation needs to be thoroughly supervised, whether the mother is wearing the mask, whether she is doing the hand hygiene properly or not, whether she is cleaning her breasts, and then run through the whole steps multiple times with each mother. Milk delivery to the ICU should also be modified where the mother is already at home, she's bringing in the milk, then it should probably, in our unit, we change from twice a day to once a day. Promote meticulous hand hygiene and respiratory hygiene at every contact with both mother and any other family member that we come across. If kangaroo mother care is offered, that needs to be done in an isolated room facility, such as family-centric room that we have, or incubator care should be offered for all those babies who go into KMC and come out of KMC and then go into incubator. So a lot of changes are happening to our day-to-day practices as compared to what we normally used to do before the pandemic. Neonatal COVID, can present with as vague symptoms as possible. They can present with lethargy, some bit of respiratory distress, temperature instability. There can be mild suggestions from the blood samples that we do, like leukocytosis or leukopenia or lymphopenia or thrombocytopenia. So we should always have high index of suspicion. Go through, if a symptom is not explained in a neonate who is term or preterm, then I think we should go over the symptomatology of the mother and other family members. To sum up, we are living in a scenario that we have not seen before. Many of us have not seen before, and probably we may not be seeing another pandemic as such as this. But we need to evolve and we need to respond so that we survive this. Probably this COVID is not teratogenic. Probably does not add to any of the obstetric morbidities that we are aware of. Doesn't change practice. Probably subtle changes in practices here and there so that it suits the suits our scenario, our practice. Hospital needs to be geared up. Multiple drills have to be conducted different times, not just day or night, multiple times, so that we understand where are the loopholes and strengthen those loopholes. Personnel need to be trained. There should be separate designated set of staff taking care of sick ones. Well, babies, the choice of feeds and the place of feed, we have a choice, but then, like I said, promotion of rooming in, early breastfeeds, and then early discharge and teleconsultations where possible. Sick babies, they definitely need a special NICU care so that they are catered to away from the other normal healthy newborns who are non-COVID exposed. So thank you, and we are open to comments and questions. So if there are no discussion points from this webinar, we would like to log out, and we'll be open to all sorts of questions and discussions via our telephones, via our mails, so that we can continue this understanding of this particular pandemic over the next multiple days. Thank you all.